Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, guys. We are going to be talking about the crew beta, GTA 5 having first person mode, Need for Speed No Limits, and Fast and Furious 7. This is episode 3, and let's get into it. So first of all, we're going to talk about, I think we should start off with Fast and Furious 7.
Yeah, definitely.
Personally, I thought the trailer was okay.
Really?
And yeah, just okay.
Okay.
And I also feel like, as I feared, the series is going over the top and too cluttered,
As you imagined.
Begins with an S, but you know, whatever. So basically, I think I've spotted a new character. They kind of rescue a girl from the kind of bus thingy. And she's got to be important. So I'm wondering, you know, isn't this getting a bit too cluttered now? Also in the trailer, you spot Luke Hobbs just mindlessly shooting a Gatling gun into air. And yeah, I'm starting to feel how Cam feels about, it's all about shooty, shooty, bang, bang now. So yeah, okay. What do you guys think?
Well, I didn't really think it had much context. Like, when I was watching the build-up, like the hour-long build-up, and they were saying, oh, well, what's bigger than going to Abu Dhabi? And I'm thinking, what correlation does Abu Dhabi have to the Fast and Furious series? Like, it has nothing to do, like, oh, that's where everyone with big fast cars goes. And I'm like, no, just no. The actual trailer itself, I don't think it was that bad. I thought I was watching Fast and Furious, was it 5? Is that the one, like, when they go to Brazil?
Yeah.
The one that you liked. I watched that because you said it was really good. Just for that one moment when he goes, we're in Brazil. Like, I watched it all the way through just for that moment. And I think I really kind of underestimated that film. That film is actually really good. It had like a lot more street racing than I originally, you know, thought that I had. But the Fast and Furious 7 trailer, I would say it's just more of the same, really. I enjoyed the previous films. Not as much as the first three, but I enjoyed them. So I'm looking forward to see, you know, what actually comes in the future with Fast and Furious 7.
Okay. So it seems like I'm the only one that really enjoyed that trailer. I really like that trailer. Multiple reasons. It just looks amazing. I mean, the beginning of the trailer, they drop cars out of a bloody plane and they parachute down. And then they go to rescue some girl from the back of some bus that has turrets on the side of it. It's like, that's crazy. That's on the trailer. But I was thinking at the same time, like, people want it to be about racing and such, and you didn't really see much racing in that trailer. Mm-hmm. Like, you saw clips, obviously, of it skimming through parts of the movie and such. And there must have been, like, that one race, and then where the car's pulling a wheelie, and that's about it. Like,
yeah, like,
everything else was all shooting.
I was watching the Fast and the Furious, the one in 2009, and I watched the one Martin told me to watch, Fast 5, and those actually had a lot of racing in compared to the newest one, like a lot of racing in it.
Yeah.
It all kind of made sense, you know, drug cartel going through Mexico and stuff. It kind of seems like Fast and Furious 7 is, it's kind of just adding on, it's kind of selling out, I guess, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I don't know, like, from the start, like right at the beginning of the Fast and Furious, like the beginning of the first movie, they're stealing things, they're getting money, that sort of thing. I feel as if, personally, I feel as if the racing was just in there because, I don't know, maybe the actors suggested they like cars.
The trend of the time.
Yeah, maybe it was the trend, you know, that sort of thing. Well, that has died down, like not many people... Nobody likes racing.
I think
Nobody,
it's making a comeback,
right?
To be honest. I really do.
No, I don't think it is. Like, people will know a Bugatti Veyron. People will know a Lamborghini. They won't know what a Lamborghini is, but they'll know it's a Lamborghini. You know, that sort of thing. Cars, to most people, are just, it looks nice.
Yeah.
But now they're stealing for no reason.
But like... guns... Everybody likes guns. Everybody likes explosions and action and people fighting, and it's just kind of got like everything. So I don't know. As you were saying, it might get a bit too cluttered, but I'm not sure at the same time because GTA. Yeah, I'm sure there's a few films that kind of try and do everything, but they seem to pull it off all right, I guess.
I mean, I'm going to watch it.
Definitely.
We're all going to watch it.
Yeah.
It, when it comes out. Is it in April or March?
Because of the American way they date the month and stuff. I think it's, yeah, April. 3rd of April.
Okay.
Yeah, so I might go watch that before my mom's birthday.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to watch it. Like, probably on the day. I'll probably go by myself again. Yeah. And watch it.
Sorry, do you want to say something?
No, I'm okay.
Yeah, Fast and Furious, man. I just, no matter what comes out, I will watch it and I will like it. Mm. And not everything can be about racing, you know. Like, this is a revenge story. Ian Shaw's brother wants to get Dominic Toretto on his team back, right? He's not going to be like, hey, I heard you're a good racer. Let's settle this by a race. So, you know, like, yeah. Fast and Furious is evolving, and I don't mind where it turns into. But, you know, as long as they're...
Well, it has to evolve racing in some way, because, you know, at the end of Tokyo Drift, when Dom was with, what's his name? I know his real life name is like Sean something. Is it Sean?
Yeah, it is
the main character. Them two at the end, and they're like, are you ready, kid? And he's like, I'm ready. And they're kind of facing off. That has to play into Fast and Furious 7 somehow.
Exactly.
That one racing.
Tokyo, no.
It was a pointless scene then, if it doesn't.
Yeah, but I mean, it gave you like the hint that obviously it's the same timeline. It's still tied in, you know.
But it doesn't link completely.
Yeah, I guess you don't really need to know everything, like that links into the whole thing. Like they probably will if this is the last film, then it'll probably be in there. And if it's not,
I don't think it is, because I remember I was watching an interview and Paul Walker said he would want this series to carry on. Ironically enough,
I think that they will, because as people say, it would be respectful to end it here, but it's not just about that one character. It's always been about other people that he's met
The quote unquote family.
And it's not as if they've all gone. They're all still there, and this is like I think they said it's like their best money making film, pretty much. So it would be a bit silly to really just end it when they could make a lot more from it.
Yeah, some guy in the comment section, to be honest.
Oh, that would be cool. Some guy in the comment section said that they want to make 3 trilogies. So that's the first 3, then up to 6, and then 7, 8, 9. So yeah, I do expect more. But what was I going to say? Clips. Continue. All right, go on.
I had nothing to say.
I don't know, like, if they do continue.
Oh, I remember what I was going to say.
Oh, you go on then. Go on.
Yeah. The easiest thing they could use to retire Paul Walker's character is he's got a kid now, right? So they could use that and let the story continue.
But then how old are the characters are going to get? So say his kid grows up, like, to what, 15, 16? And then how old is, like, Dom and Letty and all them not going to be? They're going to be really old.
Mm-hmm.
And that would completely be retired as well, and don't really want that, to be honest.
If they do carry it on, it's still going to be massively budgeted, and you know, so they're going to figure it out. They're not dumb, pretty much. Yeah. They know what to do. They wouldn't just mess it up, because they know that there's a lot of people that love this film, and
serious.
With Tokyo Drift, I wasn't really on the internet and stuff around the time of that film coming out. I wonder if there was kind of any people complaining because it wasn't as much about everyone else, like in the family.
Well, from friends and just like friends and family and stuff, no one really complained about it. Yeah. Like that.
So I'm thinking maybe if they wanted to continue it for a really long time, they'll go off and kind of create separate stories for different people, and maybe they'll join in, kind of link up in some way. And, you know, they could do a lot with that, because it still has the name of Fast and Furious.
You know how some series just go on for ages and ages, like Final Fantasy, Mario, what film examples can I think of? James Bond. I don't think Fast and Furious is going to be the next like James Bond, if you know what I mean.
Right.
Yeah. I don't think it has that lifespan. Like, you can already see the films are getting bigger and it's grabbing more of an audience in, but more of the hardcore fans, and they're kind of straying away to it, if you know what I mean. And if the hardcore fans stray away to it, then, well, the casuals aren't really going to watch either. if you kind of know what I mean.
Yeah, I know what you mean, but I think it still just has the name that grabs people.
And it's not going to be the same without Paul Walker in the next one when that eventually releases.
It won't be the same.
It's quite deep, to be honest.
It will be, you know, drastically different without having him in there. But it doesn't mean it's going to be less enjoyable because, for example, Tokyo Drift, that was a really good film still.
But that was a spin-off, though. That was a completely different film throughout the time.
We
didn't know anything about that Han bloke. We didn't know anything about Sean and all that lot.
It fits in with the timeline and such. But, I mean, if they can pull that off and still do pretty well with it, then surely they can do more of that.
I wouldn't mind another spin-off film, to be honest. But it has to relate to racing if it's going to be a spin-off.
It's obviously can't just be Fast and Furious without any form of vehicles.
Well, think about it. They've already done drag races. They've done drift races. What else is there left?
Well, I don't know. It's always been about cars, though, hasn't it? Like,
what type of racing is there left? There isn't any left.
They're not kind of doing that. There's drag races in the first one, and there was the street racing in the first one, and it was pretty much everything in the first one. And
for us, this is more like the character falls into some kind of trouble and then racing their outcome.
Yeah.
And the racing is kind of... I guess you could say, like, maybe it was just something they wanted to add in.
Like, it didn't really make sense. I'm not sure if you guys remember Tokyo Drift. When he went into the accuser's lair, and he was like, me and your nephew have caused so many problems, let me settle this in a race. Like, that didn't really make sense. You're the head of the fucking accuser. Like, you could easily just shoot his ass if you wanted to. Like, although it's a good idea, like, to have the ultimate race, end of the film, this is what everything leads up to, it doesn't really make sense.
Mm.
If you know what I mean. And, like, it's that... I don't really, like, miss that from the old films, but I definitely do miss, you know, having everything about, you know, like, everything would lead up to a street race, and then something would happen at the street race. Maybe, you know, Dom would be saved by Brian, and then, you know, something would lead off onto that. That's what I miss, is when something... What I miss is when the actual main event was the race, and then something happens because of the race. The action happens after the race, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I miss. But what I don't miss is just, like, you know, the end of Tokyo Drift when he's like, let me settle this with the race, because it doesn't make sense, because his granddad is the head of the Yakuza. Like, he can literally do whatever he wants. He owns Japan, basically. And that didn't make sense to me.
Mm.
So with Japan, it's like kind of a tradition to settle things in a way where you think you're both skilled. So that kind of...
Is that actually a thing, though?
Yeah.
I actually never knew that.
It is. It's like, okay, you race, I race. This would be the way to settle it without trouble.
But he's the Yakuza boss. He's not like... He always has trouble. He's the Yakuza boss. I bet he's always, you know, dealing drugs. He's doing this, doing that. Like, really?
I don't remember I don't remember too well, but was it DK who proposed the race or the Yakuza boss?
No, Sean did. He went into his lair.
Yeah, and said to the Yakuza boss, I won the race, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the granddad was confident in his grandkid that he would win. DK would win. And
oh, yeah, yeah.
But even when he lost, like... He could have easily got a gun out and shot Sean. Like, he's the Yakuza boss.
Yeah, but I guess there it might be a thing to, you know... Well, I myself, if somebody beat me, then rather than just killing them... that's just kind of like saying, oh yeah, I know
it wouldn't make sense
win.
For the film, but it literally that is a literal thing that could happen.
Yeah, but it would be more important to me to beat that person rather than just kill him, because that's just saying, oh, I can't beat him, I'm just going to kill him.
It does sound very stupid, actually.
Yeah, just kill him because he beat me.
Just shoot the bastard because he beat me.
Yeah, if you beat him, obviously, you know, you've earned the respect back and everything like that. So I don't know. That kind of makes sense to me.
We really, like, digressed a lot off the Fast and Furious 7 trailer. So should we think of some thoughts? Final thoughts to round it all up.
Okay.
Theo, you want to go first?
Okay. I'm very excited for the film. I believe it might be one of my favourites just from going from the trailer. But trailers with movies seem to have this thing where they're very, very exciting and awesome, and then it's like, oh, it's not
all
not
the exciting moments yeah. are in the trailer.
Yeah. So I'm just hoping that it's as big budget and polished as I'm expecting, and it looks pretty good.
I think I am really excited for it. Like, ever since I can remember, I've always been watching Fast and Furious films. So this one, no exception, is obviously going to get me very hyped. I'm a bit wary. I'm going to go into it with not too high expectations. I'm not going to, you know, set the bar above, you know, like Tokyo Drift or Fast and Furious, the originals. I'm going to set my bar quite low, I think. But I have hope that this will be a good film. And hopefully it will be. I mean, I guess we'll just have to see, you know, in April when it actually comes out.
Hmm. All right. So I'm looking forward to it. I will definitely be watching it in the cinema. Must have cinema experience. But
yeah.
I'm also wary about it. I think, as I said, there's too much characters right now. There's already three for this title, three new ones. That's Tony Jaa's character, Jason Statham, and whoever that girl is. And, you know, I'm still worried about the Paul Walker body double business. And, yeah, just going to have to lower my standards, like Cam said.
Yeah. I've got a question. Do you think this film will be in 3D?
I hope not.
Right. I'm not going to watch it in 3D.
I have a thing with 3D. Like, I will probably, if it is available in 3D, it most probably will be, I will probably watch it. And the only reason for that is because it just, once again, be able to be like, yeah, 3D's not worth it. I don't know why I just like doing that. It's just one of those things. Because I remember from, like, every film I've seen in 3D has been absolutely useless to see in 3D. There's, like, two or three scenes that are in 3D. It's like, oh, look at this car going
Spider-Man,
past in 3D.
I thought Spider-Man was going to be the best 3D film ever. There's so much they could do with that.
Yeah.
And it was just one falling scene. Like, when you're in a tunnel.
in Need for Speed, it was like when the dog makes you jump. And that's all I really remember. And the jump through the air with the leaves flying everywhere. That was literally the only two 3D bits.
What about the helicopter?
I can't remember them. No. But honestly, if it was 3D the whole entire film, I didn't notice it because it just seemed flat for most of it. And there was
it's just a nuisance
moments.
Wearing those glasses. That's all it is.
Yeah, it really is. I don't know. I if it's good in 3D, that's a problem. Like, if it's got a lot of 3D stuff, I'll want to see that, obviously. But if I'm getting the 3D glasses and it's got two or three scenes that are in 3D, I'm going to be like, well, that's a waste of money. I've got these annoying glasses on my face. I look like an idiot.
Well, at least everyone else in the cinema looks like an idiot as well.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'll be pretty upset, to be honest.
Why don't they just have, like, a big screen over the actual screen?
That's actually a great idea.
Why have they not done that?
Why did it like get a lens?
Yeah.
That's going to be too expensive.
Yeah, probably will be it.
But, maybe. I mean, it would pay off in the long term.
Yeah. Well, no, because they get to sell the 3D glasses.
Oh, do they? Pretty sure they reuse them, don't they?
They can, like, charge.
Oh, yeah, they charge.
My cinema charges for them.
Yeah, because I know at the IMAX in Birmingham, which is the one I usually go to for watch any big film, because otherwise I just stream it online. obviously, completely legally again. I don't do that on illegal websites. But yeah, what they do is they they give you the glasses, then they take you off them at the end and put them in a big box and wash them and then reuse them.
Wow, that's extra.
Yeah, here we get to keep them, but they're like £3 for the glasses, I think.
Yeah.
Jeez. Yeah, I do know where places where they do that, but the place I go, they don't. Anyway, should we move on to the
crew
later?
One last question before we change topic.
Okay.
On the Facebook page, someone wrote in the comments on the Fast and Furious page, they said there better be a Paul Walker tribute at the start of the film rather than at the end. How do you guys feel about that?
Either way, I don't really mind. As long as they remember his death, I don't mind how they do it, to be honest.
Mm. Myself, I wouldn't mind it at the start, but the thing is, it might be, I don't know. It's like having like a big intro in a video, I guess. It's kind of like, get to the point, please. Come on, hurry up.
Yeah.
I know that sounds horrible, but for the people that are buying the movie and paying to watch the movie, I think the fans will watch all the way through because people like us will watch past the credits. We'll be sat there where everyone's getting up. We're like awkwardly sat there waiting for something else to come on at the end of the credits.
Yeah.
So I think that would be better like towards the end or while the credits are going, that sort of thing.
I mean, for like TV shows and stuff, you do see, like, say if someone in the director's crew or like the actors, one of them's died, you'll see that at the end with a picture and like it'll say like rest in peace or something.
Yeah.
So I think it would be better suited at the end, but I'm really not bothered for like minuscule details like that, to be honest.
Mean, if it's like a minute or two long at the beginning, fine, sure. But if it goes on for too long, it's a bit like, risky, I guess, for them as a company.
I've got a question. Who actually buys films anymore? Like, really? We've got Netflix, and then we've got, like, you know, other streaming services.
I know people that buy, like, illegal DVDs. But, like, not official ones. I know some people
just to stream it.
At Christmas, for example, get, like, a Blu-ray box set of their favourite movie or something, but they don't go, oh, that movie's out on DVD soon, I can't wait. Like, it's not like that.
Anyway, should we move on to the crew?
Yeah,
it's time. Okay. So for Theo and I, well, more so Theo, I've only played like 15 minutes. But Theo has already had his hands on the crew. So do you want to talk about the differences in the handling, firstly, I guess?
I'm going to make a video dedicated to it, so I'll kind of just give a short version. But basically, they've improved the handling model a lot.
I was about to ask you that.
Yeah, they've improved it a lot. Like, I saw it on the site, on the change logs, and I was thinking, right, okay, they've changed it, whatever, sure. Because, you know, when you see a change log like that, you're like, you don't think it's going to be a drastic change. But from what I played now, I can literally floor the car through the slalom test. Like, before, if you did one of those events, you'd spin out even on, like, full assists.
What assist did you use?
I tried it on a couple. So I tried it on hardcore, and you can't push the car completely through the slalom tests because it will spin out, but you can kind of do it with letting go of the throttle every now and again. But full assists, you can just floor it through it, literally. So they've improved it a lot. So, you know, it's going to be more welcoming to the people that first jump in. And if you still want that hardcore handling model, it's not exactly the same as it was. It's not as slidey. It's not as jumpy. Like, one thing I noticed, you know, when you slide through a corner last time on the last beta, you would kind of feel like once you get out of that, you'd feel like you've lost control completely. You go up a jump, you kind of, you've lost it completely.
Yeah.
When you did it on, I did it on hardcore on this, it felt as if the car just snapped back to the road. It felt a bit weird because I'm used to it not doing that, but it felt better because I didn't lose control. So it's like as if it's more attached to the road now than it was before, which is a good change because if before it felt a bit slidey, which was got annoying in races when you're like last corner, span outs. But yeah, they've improved it on, it's honestly like, you can tell it's the same handling model, but it's as if they've made the circuit spec, took the circuit spec and put it on, based off that for every class of car now. It's really good.
Yeah, well, I'm probably going to talk about it as well, so I'm not going to go too in-depth. But I will say it still feels slidey. It still feels like the crew, if you know what I mean. But if I had to compare it to a game, I would definitely say it feels a lot more like the old Need for Speed games, if you know what I mean. Again, like it is still very, very slidey. I think if I had to explain it with a game in one word, it would be Need for Speed Most Wanted, but very slidey.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's how I would explain it. They've really improved it. I mean, in handling wise, they've improved every, you know, other problem I have. The only one other thing I want from this game is a wider selection of tuners. Well, two things actually. So a wider selection of tuners and a vinyl editor and with a marketplace like Forza. If they add these two features, which I'm sure they'll add the cars and DLC packs, but if they end up adding like a vinyl editor, I will say the crew will be up there with my favorite racing games of all time. I'm not going to say it's my favorite, but I'll definitely say it's up there with my favorite, definitely.
Literally going from the beta, from what I played before, it is mine already. Like, just because of the amount to do and the amount of variety that you can do already, it's good. But
I mean, you can definitely tell, like, through the first, second, and third, and obviously coming on to the fourth beta now, the game has really changed.
Yeah, it has.
Yeah, like me and you, they've played. Martin, have you played any of the betas? Or
Nope.
Well, if you've been like me and Theo and you've played through every single beta, you will notice a drastic change, like a very, very drastic change. And I think that there is some things which I missed from the first beta, but I'm very, very glad that the game is how it is now, to be honest.
It's good to hear, because I had this horrible feeling that the crew would just flop. I don't know why. I just
the first beta, honestly, I had that feeling. I thought, oh, this is so underwhelming. I was expecting so much more. And to be honest, customization wise, I'm still expecting if GTA gets neons, why can't the crew have neons? That's all I'm saying. You know, like, I was very underwhelmed with the body customization. I think to an extent, you know, not having, like, licensed rims, not having, you know, so many bumper options. Like, the bumper options are all kind of the same, and they change one or two things, if you know what I mean. Like, having, like, not having these in-depth options, I guess I'm kind of disappointed in a way that it doesn't really match Underground 2's level of customization. But yeah. I'm very glad gameplay-wise and that they've really brushed up everything, like, everything. And I think over time, playing the different betas, I've really started to appreciate what Ivory Tower are doing more, if you know what I mean. And I have faith in Ivory Tower.
One thing that you have to really appreciate is that even though we've had access to two specs, we've still got, is it three or four more left to play about with? Yeah.
Like, so far, and we've had the perf spec in that one race, the raid spec a few times in some of the races, we've raced with the circuit spec, we've raced with the street and dirt spec, and I think there's one or two more, if I'm right or wrong.
Yeah, but I mean, there were quite... Right, for some cars, there aren't a lot of customization options, but if you think you've got that, and then you've still got the two... You've got the performance and circuit spec to play around with for racing, and then you've still got the raid spec to play around with later on. You know, and for every car, there must be... I don't know, there must be at least 50 pieces bumper-wise and 50 pieces rear bumper-wise, if you think about it.
In hindsight, if you think about it, so we've only had the street, dirt, and stock, obviously.
Yeah.
Think about that. Just think about how much time me, Theo, you know, like EK, all of us have made videos just on them two specs.
Exactly.
Just think about that. And then think about it for all of the specs. Think about how many ideas and how many things we can do with those specs. If the beta has literally came up with new ideas every single time, imagine what it's going to do, you know, when the full game releases in December. It's just going to be mental. Like, there's so many options.
They are so rubbing it in Need for Speed's face.
Yeah.
Smell it.
Smell it.
I genuinely think Need for Speed's going to step it up another gear next year.
Do you want to carry on or...
Yeah, that's actually our next topic, Need for Speed. So, yeah, go on.
All right. Yeah, as I said, one thing before we move topic completely. They are expecting, I think it's 2 million in the first year sales-wise.
No way.
The crew or...
The crew.
Okay.
So
2 million. Wow.
Well, maybe, actually, to be honest. I wouldn't count it out.
Right, so for some comparison, GTA sold like 32 million, was it? And obviously,
and that's arguably the biggest racing, biggest game ever released. GTA 5. Yeah.
Need for Speed Rivals is over 2 million now. which I don't know. The thing is, you think Rivals looks like, oh, that's not a great game at all, and that sold 2 million. So why can't the crew? New IP, it's just having Need for Speed on the box, having Fast and Furious on the box, like we said before. It has that, oh, this is, you know, a big brand. We know this. It's like clothes, for example. If you see a big brand, you're like, oh, that must be high quality. Yeah. So I don't know if they'll hit 2 million. I don't want to say I doubt it, because I want them to sell more than that, obviously. For the amount of time they've put into the game, it's like 6 years in total. For them to sell 2 million, that sounds like a small number. When Rockstar, that's the only other developer that's really taken like 5 or 6 years on a game, has sold 32 million. And Call of Duty releases in a year and they sell like, what, 20 million?
You want to know why I think they'll do it? It's because good games sell. And that is honestly as simple as that. If, like, say, I don't know, I go to a friend at school and they like racing games and I say, oh, have you heard of The Crew? And they'll be like, oh, no. Remember Need for Speed Most Wanted? And they'll be like, 2012? I'm like, no, 2005. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I love that game. The Crew is the next one. And I'll say that to them. And then they'll be like, oh, my God, why haven't I heard of this game? And then they'll tell their friends. And then they'll tell their friends. And it's, you know, it's kind of the word of mouth that kind of...
Makes that's a game why Underground went, like, crazy. Like, it before Underground, it was selling... All right, it wasn't selling amazing. But then Underground, it sold like 11 million.
Yeah.
Jumped up from like 3.
I think the combination of word of mouth and actually having a great, you know, in-depth game is really going to make this game sell. And I genuinely, I think 2 million isn't you know, I think that's very modest. I
understand.
They can do it.
Like I think they can do it. I think, but there are still doubts that because it's a new IP, because I've seen a lot of people say, oh, it's Ubisoft. It's going to have Watch Dogs handling. It's like, no, that's not how
yeah,
it works.
I get annoyed when people say that.
Yeah,
oh my God.
It's really annoying.
Shut up, you idiot. You are so wrong.
That's what people think. And if people are thinking that, there's going to be other people that think that. You know, it's like... And I've actually seen a lot of people that don't like racing games normally. They enjoyed Forza Horizon 2, for example. They're hitting, like, taking the mick out of the crew because they didn't do too well on their first race or something, for example. The graphics aren't very good, and I don't know. There's just a few things that make me go, will it be able to do that? I really hope it does, though, because if it doesn't, Ubisoft isn't going to be very pleased, are they? and that's kind of where it becomes to be, you're not taking this long again to make a game. You're going to make mobile games, microtransactions all over it. And
I'm going to need a second to actually explain what I mean here. So... If you guys don't know me, I'm huge on Halo. I don't like upload it or anything like that, but I'm huge on Halo. And if you guys have actually ever played Halo 2, you'll know that game was huge. The skill gap was huge between the good and bad players. You really had to grind and get better at that game. The reason why I have, I think, so much hope in the crew, because obviously the crew isn't easy just to pick up. Like, in a sense it is, but there'll be a very big skill gap between the good and bad players in the crew. I think that's fair enough to say, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I think how big Halo 2, the anniversary, Master Chief Collection, I think how big that's got, and that game is really dedicated to the hardcore player. That is probably going to be the biggest FPS on Xbox One, if you don't count like GTA and all those other games. If you're strictly talking, you know, linear first-person shooters, and that's probably going to be the biggest, and that is like literally the skill gap and the skill it takes to play that game is huge. And then if you go over to the crew, which is kind of, think of it as the racing game Halo, where the skill gap is going to be big between the bad and good players. Not unlike Horizon 2, where it's kind of, it's not really that big, because obviously you've got the assists, which don't really transfer over, like, it's hard to explain, if you know what I mean. But Horizon 2 is a lot easier than the crew, essentially, is what I'm trying to say.
Definitely.
I think the skill gap between the good and bad players will really make the game better in the long term.
There's, have you heard about the factions? I'm sure you have.
Yeah.
That's gonna be a good way to keep, you know, hardcore players.
How many is there in the game? Five.
There are five factions.
Yeah, five.
And you get some really lengthy missions with them, so you can get up to two and just over 2 hours in a race for.
It's like side missions. It's like side missions, except actually interesting. Basically.
Yeah, and they refresh each month, and you can do PvP or those or other events for your faction, and you will contribute towards your faction. You'll get points, and you'll get a reward at the end of it. So that's a good way to keep, you know, the really dedicated and the hardcore to keep playing, because I'm pretty sure it's going to be one of the things where, oh, you can just explore the map a little bit more and contribute towards your faction. You know, you can do literally anything, because that game is literally about everything linking in somewhat. So I can do this little event and I get a part for doing it, meaning I can do this event and get more money from doing it, but then I unlock another event to get, and then I need to get a part to do that event. You know, it's everything has reason, basically. So I think the factions is going to be a way to keep the hardcore players. But I was thinking, though, just a second ago, because even if it doesn't hit 2 million, it still has the microtransactions.
Yeah, that's so really going to help.
Think that's going to help. I mean, imagine how much Rockstar makes from microtransactions when they released an update. Like, they must make a lot of money as soon as a new car drops that people really like. Because I know literally all the YouTubers straight away just literally put money onto the game to buy it. I know EK does it.
No, a lot of people glitched.
But I know Tomcat put money on, AR12 put money on, EK put money on. So there must be quite a few people that put money on to get these cars.
I don't play too much GTA Online, but I have put money on it. I'm not going to lie.
I've not put money on it before. Mine's all grinding for the month that I've
Mr.
played.
Mr. Legit over here.
I nearly cried when I got glitched money sent to me. So I literally turned my PlayStation off as soon as I got it. So
yeah, that was
fine.
So annoying. It's like, no way to decline it.
But I messaged him saying, you asshole. That was that. But yeah, I screenshotted him and got him banned, so it was fine.
Oh, wow.
Capture cards for the win.
The one thing I will say, if you want to support Ivory Tower and Ubisoft with this game, is literally just word of mouth. Just tell everyone you know.
Yeah.
Just tweet, you know, at the crew game. Oh, this game's amazing. You should get it. You know, just talk about it with in real life friends. Just really try to raise the profile of this game, because I can say hand on heart, that is the best way of promoting this game. And that's probably going to be the best way of helping Ubisoft and Ivory Tower reaching their goal of 2 million.
Yeah.
They honestly deserve it. Oh, sorry, carry on. Yeah.
They really do. 6 years.
Can I squeeze a topic in here?
Yeah.
Okay, so Driver. You just said that people cuss Ubisoft games for their handling, such as Watch Dogs.
Yeah.
But Driver, absolutely amazing. A bit slidey, but amazing. Yeah. So I'm wondering, what do you guys expect from the next Driver game? You know, the last one was kind of like in his head, like a dream, basically. So what do you expect from the next one?
Should I go first? Because I haven't actually got much to say, actually.
Yeah, you go.
I've never really played it. I played the last one, the most recent one, with on a 360 for like 10 or 20 minutes, but honestly, that's it. I think the concept was really good. I think it's a really cool looking game. She never got around to playing any of the games, so that's really all I've got to say on it.
Cool.
It was actually one of the rare games to be 60 FPS on consoles as well.
Yeah.
It's pretty good, smooth 60 FPS when I played it. I might actually try upload some at 60 FPS now. But yeah. I really enjoyed Driver San Francisco. I have never really been a big Driver guy. I started with the first one because I had a PS1. I think nearly everyone must have had Driver 1 or 2.
Yeah.
But I never really played it a lot. And with the second one, that's when you could start getting out of cars, but it was really weird and clunky. But I enjoyed what I played of them. I never really played much of the story because I was at the age where it's like, oh, I'm just going to drive around when I get the ability to, and I'm going to steal cars when I can. But
I remember everything about them.
Yeah. So the first one I actually really got into was San Francisco. And a lot of people didn't like it. I actually picked it up for £20, I think it was. Because it wasn't out for a while, but...
Having read the reviews and stuff, I think that's a pretty good deal, to be honest.
Yeah. It was... You know, I heard a lot of people didn't like it because you couldn't get out your car, you couldn't do this, you couldn't do that, but I actually really, really enjoyed the story. That final mission is one of the best I've played throughout the whole generation. It really got me into it. But I don't mind, honestly, if they keep it stuck to the car, because it would kind of be a way for that series to not be, oh, it's like GTA, it's like Saints Row. It's about the cars, it's Driver, you know, it's... And what I like as well is it's the only really open world action adventure game with licensed cars.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool as well.
I know it's actually the first time they got licensed cars, if I'm right.
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah. But I just hope that they will stick to being unique and not try be GTA, if that makes sense. Yeah. Because I quite like the focus being the cars in this.
Yeah, I understand what you mean. So should we get GTA 5 out of the way first?
I actually want to leave that for
last. Oh, shit, Martin needs to say something.
Yeah.
You asked the question, I just completely forgot.
I just wanted to leave GTA for last so that Theo can have his little orgasm at the end. So, yeah, let's go on.
Sorry, I'm so sorry, Martin. I didn't realise.
That's cool. Let's go on to Need for Speed No Limits. So this is a mobile game that I really have nothing to say. I'll leave it to you guys.
So, I know... Cam has a bit to say because he was saying on Twitter how people are kind of complaining about it.
Yeah, everyone's really making a big deal about Need for Speed No Limits and, you know, oh, this Need for Speed No Limits, it's a scam, da da da. they're trying to milk us of money and just this shit. What you got to realise is there hasn't been a Need for Speed game released on mobile since Most Wanted. So really, when you think about it, it's not the fact they're trying to release a game every year. It's the fact that there hasn't been a mobile game in quite a while for Need for Speed. In addition to this, the fact they aren't releasing a game this year is also going to help. It will help them, you know, keep the Need for Speed publicity up. It will help people talking about it. But what I don't understand is why everyone's getting a big kerfuffle about it. Because in the end of the day, it's not going to have anything to do with Need for Speed 2015. It's just going to be a mobile spin-off that, you know, 5-year-olds play, essentially. is what it's going to be. And everyone's making it seem like it's the end of the world. Oh, I hate Need for Speed now. Oh, no, Lone Limits. What is this? You know, what is this track racing? I don't even know what it is. I haven't looked into it.
There's nothing about it, really. It's pretty low information at this
point.
Hasn't
he got Ken Block in? He's like a drifter, isn't he?
Yeah. That's where they found out about it. So Ken Block posted a picture of his new... what's it called? Guy Kahana thing? I don't know.
Gymkhana.
Drift car, basically.
Yeah. Gymkhana, that's it. I don't know why I said it wrong there. Because I've watched them all. It's not like I haven't seen them. But yeah, he posted a picture of his new car. And on the bottom, it had a sponsorship, all the sponsorships, and Need for Speed No Limits was in there. So people are thinking, oh, it's going to be a new Need for Speed. IGN reported on it thinking that might be the new name of the new Need for Speed. And EA came out and said, no, it's a mobile game.
See, even Need for Speed, they were like, no, don't worry, it's not Need for Speed, it's just a mobile game. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. Just if you are literally worrying about this, just don't. Just chill.
I'm not necessarily worried, but I think it's a bit dodgy in the same sense.
I actually think it's a very good sign, because if this is the mobile game, then hopefully the console or mainstream game is not the same thing.
I think No Limits is actually a really good name.
Well, it depends what it is, because some people were saying it's going to be just a bloody poker game. It's Ken Block sponsorship and some poker, and it's like, oh, you're doing a race, not really, you're playing poker. You know, it's one of those type of games where over the place, and it's going to have microtransactions everywhere. It's going to be just a big gambling thing. So if it is that, that's really abusing the Need for Speed name to me.
To be honest, I don't really care. I don't play mobile games. If I had to say what platform I play on most is, I'm a console gamer. I am generally a console gamer. So unless the game comes out for PC or on console, I would say I'm not bothered. You can go ahead and make a porn app named Need for Speed on the
that's
on
the thing, like,
on the I don't care.
Why that bothers me is because in a lot of countries, and well, even ours, a lot of people will say, oh, it's Need for Speed. We'll download that and give that a go. And, you know, it's just bringing you in with that Need for Speed name, and it might just be a bloody poker game where it's going to rob you of all your money. You know, that's why it annoys me, because then it damages the name. And it's like...
But if someone's stupid enough to click on that app and think, well, if this is going to be the next Need for Speed, well, it, then no, you're just a dickhead and you just need to think about it.
It's not that, but it to me, it just makes it like, okay, this is a bit silly now. You know, it's like having TV-branded poker games on websites and such. You know, it's just a bit... I'm not keen on it. Unless it relates to the... If the show was about poker, or if Need for Speed has some form of poker to do with it, then yeah, but it doesn't. But if it is just literally a little mini racing game, like, I don't know, Shift 2 was pretty good on mobile, then I'd be happy with it, it's fine. If it's like Need for Speed Nitro Mobile or something like that, then yeah, it's fine. But it's just a bit dodgy if it's a poker game, which I think would be a bit weird.
Yeah, I can understand what you mean, but I just don't worry about it. If you're a hardcore console Need for Speed or PC Need for Speed player, just chill. Don't worry. It's not going to affect you really in the long term. It's not. If it does damage the brand, it's not really going to do much in the long term. It's just another mobile game.
The thing is, though, it's annoying because EA have recently come out saying, oh, we're consumer friendly, it's fine, we're your friends, and we're gonna hire some guy from Starbucks to make our company more, you know, consumer oriented. And it's like,
to be honest, if you gave me a free Starbucks every time I bought an EA game, I'll be pretty happy.
But then they pull things like this, and one worse thing is like, oh, here's Sims 4 just after we said we're going to be nice to you guys, and it's got less features than the Sims 3, Sims 2 and Sims 1. You know, it's like no, you're not being a consumer oriented company, you're just being just as you were before. It's really annoying.
I don't think we can really judge this till the game's actually out.
Yeah, yeah.
And even then, just because of this, like, debacle, I guess, I actually might give it a go now. Like, it's gave it a lot more publicity than originally, you know, anticipated. I might give it a go if it's free. If it's paid,
if it's some bloody poker game, then I'm going to be annoyed.
Oh, yeah. If it's not racing, if it's not a racing mobile game, then I won't play it. But if it's a racing mobile game, I'll give it a go.
is it now makes sense as to why they've got Ken Block, because there's no other reason why it made sense for them to work together at all before this. Like, what did he do? He just had need for speed on his car. That was about it. Well, now he's going to be the face of this app.
Well, not necessarily, because sponsorships like this happen all the time. Like, all the time in Formula D, in everything. Like, I've seen Forza logos on cars. I've seen Need for Speed logos on cars. Like, I've even seen Gran Turismo logos on cars.
Yeah, but that kind of makes sense, because that's about track racing. That's, you know,
but
Need for Speed is race.
Need for Speed has been about track racing, if you think about it.
Yeah, but Ken Block doesn't race.
Drifts, yeah, I guess.
He just drifts around on his YouTube channel. And that's about it. Like,
he still has something to be cars.
He's very
though.
Good. He's very good, I must say. You know, all-wheel drive, master race and all that. but now...
No, you're going to just leave loads of fanboys in the comments now.
Hey, he drifts all-wheel drive. I can drift all-wheel drive. It's fine.
You're a noob. Get me... Me, you, 1v1, Forza Horizon 2, I'll be in my RX-7. Come at me.
I've actually only been using rear-wheel drive recently, so...
Well, Horizon doesn't count. Horizon's not a real game.
Yeah, it's not a real game. It's a pretender
one. I'm joking. That was a joke. Calm down.
But yeah, I should probably move on. But I guess, like, if it is a proper, you know, mobile game racing, like Shift 2 or Most Wanted, because those games were pretty good. Hot Pursuit, I think, was on mobile, was it?
I have actually played Hot Pursuit and Most Wanted on mobile. They're pretty good.
And they're all right. They're not bad, are they? And your speed points counted towards your actual game, like on Most Wanted. So that was pretty cool.
That they had the M3 GTR. I remember that in Most Wanted, but I never got around to it.
If they do more like that, and if this somehow contributes towards the actual full game of, you know, that's coming out, that would be pretty cool, and I'd play it. But if it's a poker game, no.
I very highly doubt it will be a poker game, to be honest.
Whatever it is, I actually think it's going to be a good sign, because it's got to be different from the 2015 mainstream game.
Oh, yeah, so definitely.
The further away from what 2015 is, then the better sign that we're getting of what we want 2015 to be.
And it kind of proves, like, Need for Speed's alive as well. It's not going anywhere. It's still here. You know what I mean?
So, two more things on this, actually. Might be just a little game where you do stunts as Ken Block. Could be that.
I don't think Ken Block will be the main character. No. Otherwise, it'll be like Ken Block's Need for Speed, no limits.
Yeah.
You know?
If they rename the series from then to Ken Block's Need for Speed.
Oh, no! Just like the first
one. You gave them ideas. Why did you do that?
The first one was like Road and Track presents the Need for Speed. They just bring that back. We're going back to our roots.
So one other person on NeoGAF also said, it may be our first look at Frostbite Go, which should be pretty cool as well.
Is that like the Frostbite mobile?
Yeah. So they managed to run Battlefield 3, a dumbed down version, on I think it was Nvidia's based smartphones. So that was really cool. Yeah. So I think it'll be pretty cool, like, if they can get, because Rivals isn't very, I'd say Rivals is just as extensive performance wise as Battlefield 3.
Yeah.
So can we get like a Rivals looking game? Because Rivals looked really good on PS4.
I don't want that.
Will it look as good? I mean, this mobile game, will it look like a decent bloody game on the mobile for the first time ever? That'll be pretty cool.
I don't want it to rival with consoles, to be honest. It kind of just takes everything away from the consoles, doesn't it?
Well, no, because it's Need for Speed. It's not as if it's GTA.
But GTA might come there soon. And they might use this a Frostbite similar engine.
Even still, like, if this is... This is a whole nother topic we could talk about in the future, but mobiles won't replace home consoles, because having that little tiny screen, if they do, it'll be to plug it into a dock and you play it on your TV. So Sony would be in there, Microsoft would be in there, you know, with their smartphones. You know, it's not going to be Samsung that instantly come to the table and like, oh, don't need a PlayStation anymore. Have our Samsung gaming hub and play your games. It's like, no. And if Google are releasing a little games console for Android, it's like, yeah, consoles are staying.
You say it's absurd, but at the same time, like, that's what we all thought when we heard a touchscreen phone. Like, I'm just saying, like, it might seem absurd now, but maybe 10, 20 years down the line, you never know.
Oh,
like,
yeah, consoles will be irrelevant in about 20 years. Like, I expect it to be. Everything will be, like, you buy a little box or a little TV.
And that'll last forever.
And that thing will... be stream content to your TV through Netflix, and you stream your games to your TV like you do with PlayStation Now, eventually when that's any good. You know,
well,
just things like that.
SharePlay,
I think, future,
really works. You know, yeah. On another note, SharePlay is actually surprisingly good.
So I think that in the future we will result to just buying a TV that we that does everything that we needed a console for and anything else for. So
yeah, I completely agree.
So yeah, but anyway, we're going off topic.
Right, we're going to GTA.
YOLO.
Yeah, can we go to GTA now? Okay. We go to GTA.
Okay, well, it's been a good podcast, guys.
Oh, okay.
Grand Theft Auto 5 has officially been confirmed to have the first person view. Now, personally, I'm not a fan of first person. I don't really like the two hands in front of the screen and, you know, the awkward turning. But I don't know what it is about GTA. I think it's the massive open world. I'm very
Definitely.
Happy to hear this feature. And that is a solid reason for me to buy the game again. This was a rumor that I was just really hoping would come true. And here we go. So I'm going to hand it over to Theo.
Now, one thing I like is they haven't just done it. They've done it in the Rockstar style. So they haven't just put a camera in the chest and that's it. You know, it's not just a little mod that they've laid onto the top of the game. They've literally gone all out and done hundreds of new animations for each gun, for, you know, jumping out of a plane, for, you know, swimming, literally everything. And it's not only being able to do everything again, but in first person, it also has... I forgot what I was going to say now.
Was he going to talk about the settings?
Yeah, that's what I was going to start about. Yeah, the settings. So you can, if you don't like first person, if you don't like third person like it was before, you can customize everything. So you're able to make it so if you take cover behind a wall, it instantly goes to third person. So you can shoot over the wall third person, come back out, back in first person. Get into a car, it can switch to third person. You know, it's got all these settings. It has field of view sliders on a console. Since when does a console have field of view sliders? But there's just a lot of things that just make you go, yeah, that's a Rockstar game. They haven't just laid this on, slapped it on. They've got parts where, say, you know, when Trevor's jumping over the train in that mission, it looks to the left like it's they've actually done some keyframe work. It's not just you're in first person that whole mission. There you go. They've gone through the whole game and pretty much made it into a whole new game if you play it in first person. Now, I'm not really big on first person. I've always loved GTA's third person. It just felt to me... I've always liked third person games because, say I customize a character online, in GTA Online, in first person, I'm like, that character's not there anymore. I can't see it. Like Skyrim, you spend ages customizing your character and then you're in first person most of the game. It's like, yeah. It's kind of like... Is there a much point? But I have the option to change that. I can be in third person when I want to, or go to first person all of a sudden when I'm in a street race, which will be much more intense than third person, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm really excited about this. And it's not only that, they've added, you know, a lot more cars in, a lot vehicles overall. They've added over 100 songs. Obviously, the game looks much better and it doesn't run at like 25 frames a second anymore.
Is it 60 or is it 30?
No, it's 30.
It's 30.
If it was 60, I don't know what's in that PlayStation, but wow. Like, running that game at 60 would be just incredible. And every other developer would be like, well, shit. They've tapped into the secret power of the PS4. And, you know. But if I want to get 60, I'm going to play it on PC. I'm probably going to get on PC as well, because I want mods.
Yeah.
Just imagine now, a DayZ multiplayer mod in GTA in the first person.
Oh, wow.
You know, there's just so much you can do. I can't wait. Obviously, I've got a few things that I'm thinking in team deathmatches, in, you know, other team games, will I be able to set from the lobby if they're all in first person or if they're all in third person? Because the third person guys are going to have a massive advantage in deathmatches because they have the... Well, I'm guessing it's going to have better auto-aim and you can literally press the button to look behind you and you've got, you know, more area to see. So I don't know. I'm just thinking, like... Well, because they've done the keyframe stuff, like the camera looks to the side when you see a train going underneath you, I'm sure they would have thought about this. They're not just going to, like, completely ignore the fact that this could be an issue. But I'm still thinking... We may run into things where that might not work so well in first person, because of how big it is and how it's always been designed for a third person view.
Mm. Yeah.
But I think it does definitely add a new layer to the game. Definitely. Like, it makes you, I think it makes you appreciate the world a lot more, because think of how many cars are in GTA. A lot of damn cars, and all of those cars have dials, and you know, the whole interior created. It's not even a racing game. Not even Grid could do that. It's embarrassing.
Let's not talk about Grid Autosport, because that is fucking shit.
But this is like Rockstar's launch. Rockstar's first dedicated FPS game, right?
Yeah.
And yeah, it's looking very good. So kudos to them.
Honestly, like, and you just think this is a studio that made Lemmings. Like, they made Lemmings as their game, and they got bought by some company, and now they're making like the biggest budget game ever. I want to know how much it actually cost them to make the next gen version, because if it cost them, I think it was 500 million, was it? No, 300 million to make GTA 5. How much more money have they spent customizing all the interiors of the car, like creating the whole interiors of every single car, and adding hundreds of animation per gun for this game, like just for this? And now with GTA 6, our expectations are going to be higher than ever. So what are they going to have to do to produce something much higher quality than what they've already done? Because I just see this game as defining, really, of what I love about games. It takes you to another world rather than just literally you're playing a game. Because you're in first person, you're that character now. You get into that car that you've bought. You know, you see all the dials moving as they should. You see the clock in the car literally as it should. Yeah, it's insane. How they've created a world, not a game.
So should I go now? You've been going on for about 5 minutes. Okay, so for me, I had really high expectations for GTA 5 on last gen. I played GTA 4 and I loved that game to pieces. The story was great. Everything was great. I went on to GTA 5 and I was in kind of the honeymoon period where everyone loved the game. No faults about this game. It's amazing. Then we go halfway through the year. I get bored of it. Heist is still to be announced. I'm getting bored of it. I honestly, if you asked me a week ago, I would have said GTA 5, I've got Master Chief Collection next week. But after having seen first person and just that first person mode, though, like everything about that first person mode looks amazing. I'm still not going to get it on launch. I mean, I've got Halo next week, so yeah, I'm not getting it on launch. But I'm going to keep my eyes open. I'm definitely going to watch some gameplays of it when other people play it. I'm going to see how it is after the honeymoon period when people are kind of critiquing the game a bit more. And if it still does live up to the hype, and if it still is truly GTA on next gen, I think I'll give it a go.
No matter what, I'm definitely getting GTA 5 again. Yeah. They've just given me enough. No, not day one. Definitely not. Because I'm getting a PS4 for Batman Arkham Knight.
Oh, but, yes.
That's a true next gen game. But yeah, I'll definitely be picking up GTA 5. Just, it's, you know, you're even able to transfer your online progress. So yeah, why not?
I think the most next-gen game that we've seen so far out of them all is The Crew, hands down.
I think GTA now. I really, really do. Like, next-gen, to me, at the beginning, I'd say, was, oh, it's connected worlds, it's multiplayer, it's all this. You know, if I go on a game, I see my friends driving around. But by that definition, Rivals was next-gen. In no way is that game next generation. It just had a little bit of multiplayer that didn't work properly on top of it. So I think GTA now is what I would love the whole generation to be like. And I know that's like massive expectations. It's probably not going to happen because Rockstar has the ambition and a lot of money. Whereas Activision, they have a lot of money, but not the ambition. You know, I think only Rockstar really has both of those things.
Well, coming back to what you said before about Rivals, there's a difference between a bad next-gen game and a good next-gen game.
Well, Watch Dogs.
That was a great game.
Watch Dogs was a good game, right? But the next-gen ideas was filled with loading screens and all this. That's not what next-gen is supposed to be about.
That's your typical, like, launch period, you know, free-roaming game,
Really? But that was supposed to be the next generation game. Like, everybody saw that, jaws dropped. Like, that was like, whoa.
Yeah.
This is going to be... Like, the reason it got me at the start, like, I was really, really hyped for that because they did the demo at E3, I think it was. And then at the end of the trailer, you see there's another player that was mucking about with him on the roof the whole time. And you're like, whoa, that was multiplayer? And you get the game. And it's like, no. This does not look like the game that I saw at all. Like, there's no one in my game. If anyone is in my game, it's like, oh, go in this little circle and try and find him. He's hiding in a car. And, you know.
Am I the only one laughing at when Theo said, whoa, that's multiplayer?
Yeah, but that was my reaction. That was my legit reaction. Oh, like, God. I was blown away. Like, I was not expecting that because there was no hints to what Watch Dogs was or was in development or anything, and we see a game and it takes the show completely. Like, the whole show before that, I think, was pretty much like, it's okay.
What E3 was that?
I can't remember. It must have been
2012?
2012, yeah, it must have been 2012.
Yeah, there was nothing in 2012.
Yeah. So, you know, it was just like that set my expectations for Next Generation, and no game so far has achieved that. Like, I think The Crew will manage to do that, but it's still, when you go into a PvP, you got to wait through loading. You know,
I think for me personally, actually really thinking over this, I know, Theo, you hate Halo, and I'm not sure, Martin, if you like Halo or not.
That's not, I don't, that's like cheating. Halo anymore.
You like Halo?
Not anymore, no.
Oh, okay. Well, the Master Chief Collection, 1, 2, 3, and 4, seamlessly, you can change between all of the games on one disc. That is definitely my most next-gen game. The fact that you have over 100 maps, and the fact that you have all four stories, and you have the Halo 5 beta next month, and... No, that is my next-gen game, actually, thinking about it. That is what you call seamless. That is seamless.
Like, you know what's funny? Think multiplayer would be The Crew, because I'm driving around, people get dropped into my game. So, what would you say, Martin?
Yeah, do you know what's funny? Watch Dogs is getting destroyed by a remake of GTA 5.
And I like that.
Watch Dogs was like, what did they say? 3 months is enough in Los Santos. Come to Chicago. Do you remember that?
I remember that.
And now look.
Yeah.
Honestly, if there's more to do, like post game, I probably would have played that game a lot more. Because for me, the story, I know a lot of people hated the story, but I actually kind of enjoyed it.
I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I didn't understand it completely, but I really enjoyed it.
You didn't understand it?
Is he incest? I don't understand still.
No, he's just very lonely, and he's only got, you know, that's the only part of his family he has left.
He must be incest. We must find this out.
No, that's just nasty, Theo. Jesus.
Hey!
He's just very lonely. He's not very good with women. That's what we have to assume.
I cannot wait to pick up all these games next year.
It is definitely worth playing. Like, I played paid full price for it.
I'm not sure whether...
The post-game stuff is very limited. Like, there's not a lot to do. It's like Infamous Second Son. You play the game and you're like,
what now?
The world is empty. You know, nothing... Like, when the people are talking and stuff in GTA, you feel as if you're in a real world. Like, that world has been... In Watch Dogs, it feels like the world has been designed around that character, where it's the other way around for GTA. Like, the world has been designed, and then they make characters to fit the world.
I even heard Aiden was quite flat as a character.
Yeah, definitely. Like, he wasn't very interesting at all. Like, they didn't give much backstory.
He was evil. He's just an evil little...
Yeah. He's just the most bland character ever.
I'm not sure if you guys are aware, the 28th of November, so end of this month, is Black Friday. I can almost guarantee games will be on sale. If you have a spare couple quid in your PayPal, or maybe, you know, you've got a few pounds laying around, get yourself on Amazon and pick up some deals. Because honestly, I think there will be some good deals for Black Friday.
Oh,
that's just a bit of advice from me.
If you've missed out on any games, like Watch Dogs was fun while it lasted. Infamous is fun while it's lasted. The thing is, though, I wish I didn't have a PlayStation at the time of those games launching, because paying full price for those and being so disappointed the fact that I've paid more than I paid for GTA and getting so much less out of it, you know, because these next-gen games were like £50, £55, that sort of thing at the beginning, weren't they? I paid £60 for Rivals, I think. Which is ridiculous.
I paid £25 for my PS4 copy.
£60 for Rivals.
£24 for a PS4. And then I paid £50 for PC. Yeah, I made that mistake. I paid for it twice.
I got the Killzone bundle thinking, oh, this is going to be great. I love Killzone 3 and Killzone 2. Trash. absolute garbage. Absolute garbage. Like, no. Just, ugh.
Do you know what £60 is? Oh my god.
See, I was lucky with that because I got the Watch Dogs bundle, so...
That was alright, yeah.
Yeah, I guess I was kind of lucky. But if Killzone, is that even a game?
Right. I love Killzone 2. That was like probably my favourite in the series. The comedy and everything was there. Second one, not as much comedy, but it was still enjoyable. This one, as if it's a mobile game. That's literally what it felt like.
Oh,
like,
no.
There were missing sound effects from the game. You'd fall over, and you'd see him like fall over, and there'd be no sound effect, and they'd be like, get up. It's like, they didn't make a noise to fall on the ground. How low budget was this game?
Like, all I could say is if you haven't got a next-gen console, this Christmas holiday time is the best time to get one. It really is.
What is a bit sad, though... What is a bit sad, though, is the best next-gen games so far have been... Well, and coming up this month, have been games that were on the PlayStation 3.
Yeah.
That's like... Real, or on the original Xbox and the Xbox 360. You know, it's like, really? Is this what we've come to? But I think GTA, honestly, if you think about it, if they slapped GTA 6 on the name of this, like FIFA does for the next year, like they've changed so much more than FIFA would in a year. So much more.
I think Far Cry is the, you know, the kind of beast in the bushes. I really think that's going to do really well.
Oh, I think that's going to do very well, but it's also on last gen.
So, very true, very true.
But it is, if it is anything like Far Cry 3, it'll be perfect. Like, that thing was bloody amazing. I did not expect it after playing Far Cry 2.
The only thing I'm really upset about is the fact that the white Xbox Ones and PS4s weren't out when I bought Xbox One. Because I really want a white one. I
don't like the white Xbox One. I like the white PlayStation, though.
So I might end up buying some skins for my Xbox and PS4 so I can just, like, slap it on.
It's because the Xbox One's, like, a weird plastic. It needs to be black, and the size of it, if it's a different colour... Like, they had a...
I think white would look nice with that.
They had, like, the Crew branding all over it. It's like, no! Not even that.
Yeah, all those are terrible, except the Horizon 2 one.
No, that was awful. It was yellow. Why would you have a yellow Xbox One?
Because that goes with the theme.
It's like having the Simpsons house. Like,
Don't die!
It was awful. It's like a massive block of cheese. Because the Xbox One is humongous. Like, having it next to the other consoles, it is, like, at least double the size of the PlayStation 4. And it has a power brick. Like, and having it in yellow?
Oh, shit.
It's just like, you know, I think technology should be white or black, mainly black.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I'd quite like, I think, a white PlayStation 4 with the blue light on it still, and that would be really cool.
Should we end it? We've been going for like an hour.
Yeah, we have been going for a while.
Guess what, guys? I actually remember the S word I was looking for.
What?
Speculate.
Anyway, if you guys enjoyed this episode of Up to Speed, make sure to hit the like, subscribe on all of our channels. Links will be down below in the description. And I guess we shall see you next week.
Yep, we
60
shall.
Pounds, Theo.
60 pounds for rivals.
Rivals.
Rivals.